right? So the one with the Hebrew, I'm a Hebrew Israelite, come out here in the name of Yahweh, Yahweh Shai. Right, like to start off by saying double honors to the elders of GMS and honors to your brothers that be pushing this truth up there in sincerity throughout the four corners of the earth. And you know, we just get straight into it as per usual. And we start off in 2nd Ezra, the 9th chapter and the first verse. Right, so 2nd Ezra, the 9th chapter and the first verse. And he said, he answered me then, and he said, measure thou the times diligently in itself, when thou seest parts of the signs, parts which I have told thee before. And some of those signs that Ezra was told there, we've been told the same thing as well. Namely, you got great miseries happening in these different countries, you got tribulation being pulled out, you got rumors of war, and so on and so forth, we're going to see in the scriptures. Right? And let's just read up a bit. And it says, 2nd Ezra, the 8th chapter, and the 50th verse, and it says, for many great miseries shall be done to them in the latter times that shall dwell on the earth, right? Because they have walked in great pride. And we know through the scriptures, right? If a man walk in pride, you know, pride goeth before a fall, right? And who's the proudest of all the people on the face of the planet, right? The so-called white man, Esau, right? Which is known as Eden within the scriptures, right? It says, for many great miseries shall be done to them in the latter times that shall dwell on the earth. Right, which because they have walked in great pride, because they understand. It says, but understand thou that for thyself, and seek out glory for such as be like unto thee, and like the elders bring out. We only care about the elect, and that's what the scriptures here say. Right, we only care about the elect. Most High said it himself. How can a man feel more so for the rest of the people than the Creator himself? Right, the Most High is selected his elect from the foundation of the earth, and that's the people that he's dealing with. That's the people he's going to come back and save when he comes back on the sea. All right, and it says, but understand thou for thyself, all right, and seek out the glory of such as be like unto thee, all right, for unto you is paradise open and the tree of life planted, and the time to come is prepared and plenteousness is made ready, right? A city is builded, all right, and rest is allowed. And let's just jump on that city builded. I believe that's in roundabout here somewhere. Here we go. This is 2nd Ezra, the 7th chapter and the 6th verse. It says, there is also is another thing, a city builded, set upon a broad field, right, and full of good things. What are some of those good things, right? The fact that we're going to be in a state of being perpetually blessed, right, where with the Most High is going to install the 613 laws, statutes, commandments within our minds, pursuant to Hebrews, the 8th chapter and the 8th verse. Right, where we're going to be always constantly doing right, so we're always going to be best, right? We're going to walk around with ailments, right? Bad hips and bad knees, and that's talking about the Negroes, Hispanics, Native Americans, because those are some of the curses that we have to deal with on this side. But on the other side, namely when we're in that city, right, which is a good thing to look forward to, because we ain't going to be worried about finances or so on and so forth. The Most High said we're going to be great men, right? The least amongst the Negroes, Hispanics, Native Americans in that day, the least amongst the Hebrew Israelites in that day is going to be as King David was in all of his glory, right? It says, there is also another thing. A city is builded and set upon a broad field and full of good things, right? The entrance thereof is narrow and set in a dangerous place to fall, like as if it were a fire on the right and on the left a deep water, right? That's talking about the difficulties that come to pass when you fully understand this truth, right? Fully understand the knowledge in your Yahweh Shai, right? That's talking about the difficulties that befall you as you understand this truth, right? And let's jump to Ecclesiastes, just touching on that point real quick. Let me elaborate on that point. This is Ecclesiastes. Ecclesiasticus, the 2nd chapter, from the top on down. Right, it's Ecclesiasticus 2:1. It says, my son, if thou will come to serve the Lord, prepare thyself for temptation. Right, and that's what you see the men of the Lord throughout the corners of the earth. That's what they've come to do. They've come to serve the Most High in sincerity. Right, if we were serving the Most High in vanity, we'd be doing all kind of making all kind of projects that you see these other pseudo-Israelite groups, right? They make these projects that benefit them financially. We don't do this to benefit ourselves, right? Most High has got us out here just to fulfill his prophecy, to fulfill his word, right? To where we've come out here. care in season and out of season, because it's not to our profit, it's through the fear of the Most High, that if we don't do this work, we're going to have to endure even more difficult obstacles. Right? He says, my son, if thou will come to serve the Lord, prepare thy soul for temptation. Set thy heart aright. Set your mind aright. Right? And constantly endure. Right? And make not haste in the time of trouble. Cleave unto him and depart not away, that thou mayest be increased at the last end. And that's what it all comes down to. It comes down to the last end. Right? And whatsoever is brought upon thee, take cheerfully and be patient, that when thou art changed to a lower state, right? For as gold is tried in the fire, and how's gold tried in the fire is, you know, you hit the gold, beat it, right? You put that gold through some trouble, which is the same thing that the men of the Lord is trying. The Most High said that in that day, a Hebrew Israelite man is going to be like a fine gold, man. Right? And it says, for as gold is tried in the fire, an acceptable man in the furnace of adversity. And let's just jump to Revelation 2nd chapter and 25th verse. Right, it's Revelation 2 and 25. And it says, but that which ye have already, hold fast until I come. What do we have already? Knowledge, wisdom, and understanding of this truth. Right, the Lord said, hold fast unto that until he comes back, until he returns back on the sea. Right, it says, but that which ye already have, hold fast until I come. Right, and he that overcometh and keepeth my works unto the end, to him will I give power over the nations, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron, and as the vessels of the potter shall they be broken, even as I have received of my father. So that's some of the stuff that's going to be added unto the Negroes, Hispanics, Native Americans, right? Really, all the Israelites after a certain point. But just to start off with, it's going to be the elect, right? Where the Most High is going to increase the elect first, so that the truth can be even more magnified. Right, it says, this is back in Exodus, the 7th chapter and the 6th verse. It says, there is also another thing, a city is builded and set upon a broad field and full of good things. The entrance thereof is narrow and is set in a dangerous place to fall, like as if it were a fire on the right hand and on the left of deep water. Like I'm saying, it's difficulties in you day to day, right? But the Most High said, the Most High gave us his name. Right, he also gave us his scripture, so we can get through our day to day, you know, sustaining ourselves with our daily. He said he was going to sustain us with our daily needs. So at the end of the day, it was always going to be all right. All right, it says, right, and the only path between them, right, and one only path between them, both even between the fire and the water, so small that but could one man go there at once. If this city was given unto a man for an inheritance, if we know this to be the inheritance of really that was prepared when Jacob received the blessings from our forefather Isaac, right? That was an inheritance that the Most High set up for him, right? And it says, if this city be given unto a man for an inheritance, if he shall never pass the danger set before it, right? Like some of you you Negroes, Hispanics, Native Americans, you want the easy road, right? If you ain't gonna pass through all of the dangers that's been set before you by the Most High, how you gonna obtain these goodies, so to speak, right? That you see in Revelations, the 2nd chapter and the 23rd verse, and so on and so forth. Because those are the good things. Right, the Most High setting us up on high, like he says in Deuteronomy, the 7th chapter and the 6th verse, where the Most High said that Israel is above all people. Right, we ain't above all people right now. We're in a state of captivity, right? And it's a damn shame, like the scripture says, how long you simple ones are going to love simplicity. It's a damn shame that you're so comfortable in namely you Negroes, Hispanics, Native Americans. It's a damn shame you're so comfortable in this captivity, right? And let's jump back to 2nd Ezra, and we're right at the 52nd verse. This is 2nd Ezra 8 and 52, and it says, for unto you is paradise open. We've seen what paradise is, right? And it says, and the tree of life is planted and the time to come prepared, and plenteousness is made ready. A city is built, right? Like we've just seen, we've seen a city. It said, and rest is allowed, right? Because all the Negroes, Hispanics, Native Americans do, the Hebrew Israelites do in this kingdom, is work. Right, because we're in our state of captivity right now, man. We just work day in, day out, week in, week out. We all know of a mother with two jobs or a father with two jobs. We done seen the thing. We done seen it growing up, right? That's why the scripture says there, and rest is allowed. Yay. Perfect goodness and wisdom, right? Perfect goodness and wisdom, speaking about like it says in Hebrews the 8th chapter and 8th verse, where the Most High is going to make us perfect first and foremost, like it says in like the example we've seen in Ecclesiastes the 2nd chapter, right? But that perfect wisdom also comes from what it says in Hebrews the 8th chapter and 8th verse, wherewith the Most High is going to implement the law, statutes, commandments within us, right? Now let's read on. It says the root of evil is sealed up from you, right, and weakness weakness and the moth is hid from you, and corruption is fled into hell and forgotten, right? And that's talking about, you know, that's talking about Esau, that's talking about that could be talking about Edom, that could be talking about Esau, right? It says sorrows are past, and in the end is sold treasure, the treasure of immortality, and therefore ask thou no more questions concerning the multitude that will perish, right? So we ain't supposed to be worried about the two-thirds. Like I brought out the scripture a couple of months ago, you know, going in on the two-thirds, we ain't supposed to worry about them, man. We ain't worried about the community. It's about the elect, right? Like it says in 2nd Ezra, it's like it says in Romans, the 9th chapter, around about maybe the 15th verse, right? The Most High said, I will have mercy upon who I will have mercy on. He said the same thing to Moses, right? It says, when they had taken liberty, they despised the Most High, right? Thought scorn of his law and forsook his ways. Moreover, they have trodden down his righteous and said in their heart that there is no God. Yea, that knowing that they must die, right? And that's talking about the multitude that's going to perish. Let's jump back down to the point now. This is 2nd Ezra, the 9th chapter, right? And this... go back to the point, which was right really at the top. Start from the top. It says, he answered me then and said, measure thou the time diligently in itself, and when thou seest part of the signs pass which I have told thee before, then shalt thou understand that it is the very same time wherein the highest will begin to visit the earth, right? Begin to visit the world which he made. Let's jump to Mark 13 and 8. Right, and in fact, let's start from the second verse. This is Matthew 13 and Mark 13 and 2, and it says, "Seest thou these great builders?" This is whom the world calls Jesus speaking. It says, "Seest thou these great buildings? They shall not be left one stone upon another." And that shall not be thrown down, right? And what was that talking about? That's talking about this hellfire, these ICBMs that's going to hit this place, coming from these different countries, right? That are against the philosophies that this man wants to implement, right? It says, "Seest thou these great buildings? They shall not be." And really, it's going to be coming from the Most High, because we know the Most High is going to come on the Lord's going to come on the scene by way of the Most High, right? By way of those UFOs. Right, he's gonna set it up there. He's gonna be destroying too, man. He's gonna, he's gonna be. We're gonna see it in the scriptures in Isaiah the 63rd chapter. The Most High is gonna come on the scene, and he's gonna be destroying. He's gonna be doing some work too, man. Right, so are his men. All right, he says, "Since thou these great buildings, there shall not be left one stone upon another that shall not be thrown down." And as he sat upon the Mount of Olives, over against the temple, Peter, James, John, and Andrew asked privately and says, "Tell us when shall these things be, and what shall be the sign when all these things shall be fulfilled?" So these men were hastening the day, as you're gonna see. That is the mentality that's supposed to pertain to the men of the Lord. They were hastening the day, right? It was like, man, they were so fervent in the scriptures and so fervent in the job. They didn't want to be in that kingdom. They wanted the society to be destroyed then. I said, when this is gonna come to pass, right? Because they pretty much knew that when those things came to pass, that this man, the abomination that causes desolation, was gonna be taken up the scene, and we was gonna be put back in that state, rightful state of power, right? It says, "Tell us when tell us when shall these things be, and what shall be the signs when all these things shall be fulfilled? Right? And Jesus answering then began to say, take heed lest any man deceive you, for many shall come in my name, saying I am Christ, and shall deceive many. And you see that a lot of that online, you see that a lot of that really in these, you know, in these different churches and so on and so forth. The Most High ain't dealing with all of that. The Most High said, when two or more are gathered in my name, right? And I know there ain't two brothers out here, but really in the spirit, when you're online, when you're vibing like that, really the Lord is there, right? Not in the Lord said he doesn't dwell in places made with hands, man. Right? It says, for many shall come into my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall receive and shall deceive many. And when ye shall hear of wars and rumors of wars, be ye not troubled, right? And we're hearing rumors of war, uproars, right? Sedition among men, right now in these different countries, right? In these different Middle Eastern countries, right? But really, you ain't really heard too much about the, you know, about the main countries of where the Most High is gonna bring his terrorists to. Right, but we're still hearing them rumors of war, right? Where if you're hearing China's making these higher technological missiles, right? You're hearing uproars in these different Middle Eastern countries, like I've already aforementioned, right? It says, right, and when you shall hear of wars and rumors of wars, be ye not troubled, for such things must needs be, right? But the end shall not be yet, right? So even though we hear rumors of wars and so on and so forth, that's not, we haven't reached the end, right? It says, for nation shall rise up against nation, kingdom against kingdom, right? And they shall be earthquakes in different places, and they shall be famines and troubles. These are the beginnings of sorrow. So, you know, you're beginning to see the beginnings of sorrow. You're seeing, you know, abnormal, unnatural disasters, right? Or you're so also experiencing adverse weather, right? Things that are out of season, for instance, right? It's raining out of season, and snowing out of season, and it's hot out of season, right? That's because the earth is all out of course, right? Preparing itself for the return of the Lord, where he's going to implement, he's going to put everything back in order, right? It says, for nation shall rise up against nation, kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be earthquakes in different places, and there shall be famines and troubles. These are the beginnings of sorrows. But take heed to yourselves, for they shall deliver you up to counsel. And this is talking about the men of the Lord that be, you know, righteously hold this thing of which I pray for you, I'll be part of those men. Right, it says they shall deliver you up to counsel. Right, so that's why the scripture says also in Ecclesiastes, you're going to prepare your mind for temptation. Right, because part of that temptation could be you being brought up to counsel. Right, just like how they did to the prophets before. That's exactly how they're going to do to the prophets now. Right, and in the synagogues you shall be beaten. Right, and it says, and you shall be brought before rulers and kings for my sake. Right, for a testimony against them, and the gospel must be published among all nations, right? Because we know really it's not about, you know, for the most part it's about the Negroes, Hispanics, Native Americans, right? But the Hebrew Israelites were dispersed throughout among all nations. You're gonna get a Jake looking like all different shades and colors, right? It says, that's why it says here, right? The gospel must be first published. Amongst all nations. So you're gonna get Israelites are gonna look like all different kind of nations. They ain't gonna look like your typical Negro or your typical Hispanic or your typical Indian, right? It says, but when they shall lead you and deliver you up, right? Take no thought beforehand what ye shall speak, neither do ye premeditate. But whatsoever shall be given to you in that hour, that shall ye speak, for it is not ye that speak for the Holy Ghost, right? And that's indicative of what the seven brothers did, right? If you read the story about the seven brothers that were killed for basically upholding the laws, because they didn't want to eat the swine, right? That was in second Maccabees, the seventh chapter, on that, right? And the Most High gave them the words to say, right, in that day. So we ain't supposed to be worried about, we ain't supposed to be very premeditated what we're gonna say in that day, right? Because the Most High is gonna put it within our spirit, right? But that's pretty much it in that one. And let's jump back to Second Ezra, the ninth chapter. And this is the third verse. It says, therefore, when they shall be seen great earthquakes and uproars in the world, then shall thou well understand that the Most High spoke of those things from the days that were before thee, even from the beginning, right? So right from the beginning, the Most High set it up that this earth was going to be destroyed in the way it's going to be destroyed, right? It says, all right, for like as old that is made in the world hath a beginning and an end, and the end is manifest, right? And speaking on the end, let's jump to 2nd Ezra, the 6th chapter and the 9th verse, right? Alright, so 2nd Ezra, the 6th chapter. Right, and the 9th verse, it says, Esau is the end of the world, and Jacob is the beginning of it that followeth. Right? So we know that Esau is the end of this world. And let's jump to Job 9 and 24, just to push that point on home. Right? Right, it's Job 9 and 24. It says, the earth is given into the hands of the wicked. Right? He covereth the faces of the judges thereof. If not, where and who is he? Right, so that's the scripture basically showing you that Esau is the end of the world, right? Which we know he's the wicked, and he's in the power seat right now. And Jacob is the beginning of it that followeth. That's why the scripture says in Revelation, the 2nd chapter and the 25th verse, right? To him that endureth, them are the ones the Most High is going to raise up first, right? And they're going to be in high stature, right? Like superstars, so you can understand. Like in stardom, so you can understand. Right, and this is back in 2nd Ezra, the 9th chapter, and we're right at the 6th verse. It says, even so the times also of the highest have plain beginnings and wonders and powerful works and endings and effects and signs, right? So it just as like the beginnings, when the Lord came on the scene, there was these great signs in the skies, and great things were shown in that time, right? To where with even people that weren't about this truth knew that the Lord was coming on the scene. So is the end gonna be, right? You're gonna see here great miseries and so on and so forth. Everyone's gonna know it's the end. Everyone knows, you're gonna know that the Lord's gonna return. But who he's gonna return for, they ain't gonna understand that, because it's for he's Most High revealed that knowledge, that wisdom to his chosen people, right? He's elect. Right, like I say, you know, like the elders say, right, which is GMS on down. The elders are GMS on down. Those are the people that have this truth, the pure truth, right? That's why the scripture says a little leaven if the whole lump. You can't have 99% truth. You gotta have 100% truth, right? Let's jump to reading on. It says, everyone that shall be saved and shall be able to escape by his works and by faith, right, whereby ye have believed, shall be preserved from the said perils, right? Now, how are we going to be preserved from the said perils? We're going to be in those chariots pursuant to Revelation, the 18th chapter, where it says, come up ye hither, right? And it says, shall be preserved from the said perils, and ye shall see my salvation in the land within my borders. For I have sanctified them for me from the beginning. Then shall they be in pitiful case. Right? And that's pretty much it I wanted to get from there. And let's jump to Wisdom of Solomon, the 5th chapter and the 1st verse. Right, speaking on the men are going to make it out of the set from the aforementioned perils. Right, it says, then shall the righteous man stand in great boldness before the face of such as afflicted him and made no account of his labors. And pretty much Negroes, Hispanics, Native Americans built up these different things, right? And they got them stripped away from them, and nobody's made account for the labels of them building them back up, right? Or building these kingdoms up. And it says, basically building this whole society up. The Negroes, Hispanics, Native Americans done built this whole society up, right? But like the scripture says here, right? Then shall the righteous man stand in great boldness before the face of such as afflicted him, and made no account of his labors, right? When they see it, they shall be troubled with terrible fear, and shall be amazed at the strangeness of his salvation. So it's going to be a strange salvation that the Most High is going to have for his men, right? It says, and they are repenting and groaning for anguish of spirit shall say within themselves, this was he whom we had in some times in derision, right? A proverb under reproach. We counted his life, madness, and his end without honor, right? How is he numbered amongst the children of the Most High, and his lot amongst the saints? Therefore have we erred, right, from the way of truth, and the light of righteousness hath not shined unto us, and the sun of righteousness has not rose up unto us. Right, and let's jump to Revelations, the 18th chapter. In fact, you can start in 2 Peter and then go to Revelations, the 18th chapter. Right, this is 2 Peter's, and I'm going to jump to the point around about Second Peter 3 and 8, and it says, Beloved, be not ignorant of this one thing, that one day is with the... No, let's jump down. This is the ninth verse. Right, he says, the Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering to us, but not willing that any should perish. Right, but that... But that should all come to repentance, right? That's why the scripture says all Israel should come be saved at a certain point, right? It says, but all should come to repentance, right? But the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, as we have read in the scriptures. We've seen how the Lord's going to come about and what he's going to do, right? And we're going to see further how much work he's going to put in terms of the destruction, right? You're going to see in Amos 9, chapter 8, real quick, right? It says, but the day of the Lord will come as a thief of the night, right? Now this is Amos.
Unless she's much older than Shirley. And I suppose the least thing.
The ninth chapter. And the eighth verse. It says, right? Behold, right? The eyes of the Lord power are upon the sinful kingdom, and I will destroy it from off the face of the earth, right? And how we know that this is a sinful kingdom, we read it in Second Ezra, the sixth chapter, how the wicked are in rulership right now, via cross references with Job 9 and 24, right? And we know that Israel, the Negroes, Hispanics, Native Americans, are going to have it, have the kingdom, the world, in other words, right? After this man will be taken down, right? Because two manner of people can't live together in harmony. There always has to be a person in rulership. There has to be a dominant power, right? It says, behold, the eyes of the Lord power upon the sinful kingdom, and I will destroy it off the face of the earth. How do we know it's a sinful kingdom again? Right? The Lord's statutes, commandments of the Most High are disregarded in this society, right? The Lord's statutes, commandments of the Most High is implemented from the foundations of the earth, right? Are not implemented, right? They laughed at, right? They thought of as scorn. The Most High said it, that his laws are not grievous. Really, the easy thing to, for the most part, you can't do it in a society, right? But in a pretty much average society, it's not grievous. He says these laws is not grievous, right? He says, behold, the eyes of the Lord power upon the sinful kingdom, and I'll destroy it from off the face of the earth. Saving utterly, I will not destroy the house of Jacob. Who's the house of Jacob? The Negroes, Hispanics, Native Americans. That's the house of Jacob. Right, dispersed throughout the four corners of the earth, but the bulk majority of them is the Negroes, Hispanics, Native Americans. It says, saith the Lord, for lo, I will command and I will sift, and I will sift the house of Israel from among all nations, just like I was saying, it's dispersed throughout the four corners of the earth. Right, like corn is sifted in the sieve, yet shall not the least grain fall upon the earth. right? Now let's jump back to 2 Peter's 3rd chapter. And it's the 9th verse. It says, the Lord is not slack concerning his promise, right? Right, the promise that he's made, he's going to destroy the sinful kingdom from off the face of the earth, right? It says, he's not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but he's long-suffering to us, what us would, right? Not willing that any should perish, right? We've seen that in Amos, the 9th chapter, and the 9th verse, right? It says, but that all should come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, right? And come as a thief in the night, and the which the heavens shall pass away with a great noise, and the elements shall melt with a fervent heat, and the earth and also the works that are therein shall be burnt up. So that's what's coming to this society, right? By way of the Most High. He's saying, seeing that all things shall be dissolved, what manner of persons all ye ought to be, right, in holy conversation and goodness, looking for and hastening unto the coming of the coming day of the Most High, which was Peter and them, that's what it was doing, man. When the Lord was on their scene, they said, what's going to be the signs of these things being brought down? They was looking for and hastening unto the coming of the Most High, man. They was hastening the day, right? It says, looking for and hastening unto the coming of the coming day of the Most High, wherein the heavens being on fire shall be dissolved and the elements shall melt with a fervent heat. Right, so that's the future that's coming to this place, right? Excuse me. It says, nevertheless, we, according to his promise, look for a new heaven, right? Just as you've seen in 2 Ezra 6, chapter 9, verse. It says, nevertheless, we, according to his promise, right, look for a new heaven and a new earth, right, wherein dwelleth righteousness. Wherefore, beloved, seeing that ye look for such things, be diligent, that ye may be found with them in peace, without spot and blameless, right? Which is like it says in Revelation, the 2nd chapter, and 25th. See, all these scriptures link up. That's why the Lord said he's the same today as he is tomorrow, because all of these scriptures, it link up, right? He says it comes in the volume of the book, right? Now, it's Revelation, the 18th chapter. I might just hit on the point here. Right, it's Revelations 18 and 4, and it says, and I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out of her, my people. You know what? Stuff on the top. It says, and after these things I saw another angel come down from heaven having great power, right? And the earth was lit with his glory. And he cried with a mightily voice, with a strong voice, saying, Babylon the great, Babylon, America, the land of confusion, right? Babylon the great is fallen. Right, because when John saw this vision, he already knew that Babylon, the original Babylon, was destroyed. This is talking about another place, right? It says, the great is fallen, and it's fallen, it's become the habitation of the devil, right? The hold of every foul spirit and cage of every unclean and hateful bird, right? For all the nations have drunk the wine of the wrath of a fornication, right? And the kings of the earth have committed fornication with her, and the merchants of earth have waxed rich through the abundance of her delicacies, right? Through the finances and the financial structure that is implemented, right? And it says, and I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out of my people, right? Which is going to happen in the Hebrew tongue, where we're going to hear, come out of my people, right? And we're just going to be taken out right out of this place, right? And then that's when the Most High really is going to finish off this destruction, right? Because we're not gonna be here whilst all of these nukes is gonna be going off. That's why it says in Wisdom of Solomon 5:1, right? They repenting and groaning, right, for anguish of spirit, because they're gonna be in anguish in that day when them see the missiles coming. They're gonna see the same people that they were scorning against, right? That they held in low estate, right, be risen up and saved out of this misery, right? It says, and I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out of my people, that ye be not partakers of her sins, and receive not ye of her plagues, right? For her sins have reached unto heaven, and the Most High have remembered her iniquities, right? And it's talking about the ones that are the Edomites, the elite Edomites, that managed to escape. It says, even as she had rewarded you and double unto her according to her works in the cup that she has filled. Right? And that's what some of them gonna survive that. Right, but they're gonna be the first fruits of the first fruits of captivity. That's why it says in the scriptures in Isaiah the 14th chapter, right? We're gonna take captives whose captives we were. Right, we're gonna have our captives in captivity. That's why it says also in Revelations the 13th chapter. 13th chapter. Right, yeah, this is Revelation 13:9. It says, if any man have an ear, let him hear. He that leadeth into captivity shall go into captivity. He that killeth with the sword must be killed with the sword. Here's the faith and the patience of the saints. So the Most High deals with vengeance, right? The Most High deals with the balancing of the scale. The Most High said he unbalanced scale is he doesn't deal with an unbalanced scale. All right? It says, this is back in Revelations, the 18th chapter. It says, reward her even as she is rewarded you, right? And double unto her according to her works. And the cup which she hath filled, right? Fill unto her double. How much she hath glorified herself and lived deliciously, right? So much torment and sorrow give her. For she saith in her heart, I sit a queen. I am no widow and I see no sorrow. What's that talking about? That's talking about the fact that America has never been touched with no major war. Right, no major intercontinental war like we're gonna see in the coming future. Right, this country was held in the highest state, in the highest esteem, but day by day the esteem, you know, these different countries ain't using the dollar anymore. So that estate, right, that valor that came with that country is slowly but surely depleted. Right, it says, how much she had glorified herself and lived deliciously, so much torment give her, for she saith in her heart, I sit a queen, and I am no widow, and I see no sorrow, right? Therefore shall her plagues come in one day, death and mourning, right, and famine, and she shall be utterly burnt up, for strong is the Lord that judges her. So that piece of land is going to be burnt up, man, right? Just like we saw in 2 Peter, the 3rd chapter on down. Right, so that land is going to be utterly burnt up. It says, and the kings of the earth who have committed fornication with her shall be and live deliciously with her shall bewail her and lament for her when they shall see the smoke of her burning standing afar off for fear of her torment, saying, alas, alas, right? That great city, America, Babylon, right? That mighty city. Right, for in 1 hour if that judgment come, and we've seen these weapons technologies that can bring these missiles in 1 hour, man. I see, because you can type it up in online, you can see it coming from each one of these different countries, as far as China, right? Right, as far as Russia, and even further, as far as China, right? North Koreans and so on and so forth. In 1 hour, the judgment of Babylon's gonna come, man. Right?
Hello.
You're right.
What is it?
Reading the Bible, that's all I'm doing. It says, standing afar off for fear of our torment, saying, alas, alas, that great city, Babylon, right, the mighty city, for in 1 hour is thy judgment come. It says, the merchants of earth shall weep and moan over her, for no man buyeth her their merchandise anymore, right? Because that's why these different countries are gonna be in a state of mourning, because they want this this pseudo-currencies to continue, this way of life to continue, all right? But the Most High is not gonna be dealing with that. The Most High is gonna do away with it. Let's just touch on the last, pretty much the last one. It's Isaiah the 63rd chapter, and start from the top just to give us an idea of how the Lord is returning. Right, it says, who is this that cometh from Bozrah with thy garments, who is this that cometh from Edom, right, with thy garments from Bozrah? Matter of fact, let's jump to Isaiah the 24th chapter. More relevant. Not that that's not relevant, but this is gonna be more relevant to the scriptures that we've read so far. Alright, so this is about Isaiah the 24th chapter and the first verse. It says, "Behold, the Lord maketh the earth empty, and maketh it waste, and it turneth it upside down." Alright? "And it scattereth abroad the inhabitants thereof." That's how the Lord's coming back. That's why the scripture says, right, the day of the Lord is gonna be darkness, man. Right? He's not coming back with it peaceably like he came back the first time. Right? He said, like the scripture says, I'm not gonna meet thee as a man. He's gonna come in as a celestial. Right? It says, and it shall be as with the people, so with the priest, and as with the servant, so with his master, and with the maid, and so with her mistress, as with the buyer, so with the seller, as with the lender, so with the borrower, and with the taker of usury, so with the giver of usury. The land shall be utterly empty and spoil. The Lord has spoken this word, and we know that when the word of the Lord goes out, it doesn't come unto him back unto him void. So this is actually going to happen to where the Most High is going to completely make this land waste. All right, it says, the land shall be utterly emptied, right, and spoiled, and the Lord hath spoken this word, and earth mourneth and fadeth away. Now, is the earth physically going to mourn and fade away? No, because the scripture says that the foundations of the earth stand in short, man, they stand forever. Meaning to say that the earth, the physical earth ain't going to be destroyed, but the society is going to be destroyed. Right? And the Most High is going to set his righteous society up, well, in dwelleth righteousness. Right? It says, "But the earth is also defiled and under the inhabitants thereof, because they have transgressed the Lord's," right? "They even followed the Lord's such commandments of the Most High, and if you transgress the Lord's such commandments of the Most High," right? It says, "because they have transgressed laws and changed ordinances and broke the everlasting covenant, therefore have the curse devoured of the earth." And what's that curse? That's going to Zechariah the 14th chapter and the 12th verse of ICBMs, the nukes, man, right? "Therefore has the curse devoured the earth, and they that dwell therein are desolate. Therefore the inhabitants of the earth are burnt, and a few men left. The new wine mourneth," divine language, right? Let's jump to the further down, right?